look at yourself, look at each other. You're imperfect. You know, you're short, you're flat feet, you have a bulging belly, you may lose your hair. You're clearly not perfect. And so the question is, do we want to be perfect? If you were to choose, and you can look at your, you can look at me, but you can look at your, the people sitting next to you, what are the properties that you would improve? Would they be physical, beauty? You know that beauty is just the average. We tend to only like things that are averaged out. So that is a relative concept. But maybe it is moral. Maybe you would like to improve yourself, be more patient, or maybe have a longer memory. What I would like you to do is to park this question and think about it a little bit while I continue to tell you my story. So undoubtedly, what comes out of our genome is very important for who we are. That we are humans and not another animal has to do with our genome. And I'll remind you a little bit what genomes are. The genome is the ensemble of your genes. Humans have some 23,000 different genes. They are in 46 chromosomes, 23 from your mother, 23 from your father. And they encode the sequence of nucleotides, ATTC, that make this double helix that is the inherited material that you pass on to other generation. Every cell of your body, almost every cell, has this. And what has happened is that now we can sequence genomes very easily, or much more easily than the first time, which was some 15 years ago, when the first human was sequenced. So what your generation, my generation, will face is the possibility of having your genome sequenced as part of the medical routine. And this is something that we wanted to explore in a cultural sense, in an educational sense, because we all would like to know what these genomes are before we are facing maybe a diagnostic that is based on this. And this is why this project Genome Austria was started, and this is why, based on this, I decided to have my genome sequenced first. And so this long stretch of nucleotide is something that was deciphered, and I can tell you a few of the things that happened when I started dealing with it. The first thing is it is a huge piece of information. If you were to take telephone books, you would probably build a shelf that is as big of, like, sort of the screen that is behind me, full of telephone books with this information, because it's 3 billion nucleotides, ATTCCC. If I read at this speed, which is a bit like 120 bits per minute, it would take me 50 years to read out my genome. So that is a very boring enterprise, believe me, and non-stop. Your cells can duplicate this, so they can read it and copy it in 20 minutes. While you're sitting here, several millions of times over, your cells will have read and duplicated this thing that would take me 50 years to tell you. So the first thing, that it is big. The second thing, and it is, at least at the beginning, very boring. Why is it boring? First, because you need to read a lot until you find the chapter that is interesting, because the genes are only in between a lot of other DNA that we don't quite understand. And then also, when you find the gene, often it doesn't tell you much. We start to understand the relationship between certain genes and certain diseases and certain so-called traits, but we don't quite know how the concert of the genes comes together. Anyway, when we read my genome, what came out is that I have a mutation in a gene that is called beta globin, and sort of this, the hemoglobin, and the hemoglobin is, there are two chains, alpha and beta, a mutation in the beta, is associated with a disease that is called thalassemia. It's a Mediterranean anemia. Now, luckily, I'm heterozygote, so only if I had to have a child with somebody who also has such mutation, we would have the potentially some children that have this. Now, this I knew because My family and me come from a region in Italy where there was malaria some 20,000 years ago, and it is known there's a trait that gives a little bit of protection. Then I have another mutation in a gene called hemochromatosis, which is an iron defect, an iron accumulation defect, but as I'm heterozygote, I don't suffer from it. And again, this depends on what happens with the children. And then there are some other mutations that I have. Some of them are giving a little bit of an increase in terms of the predisposition to certain cardiovascular or cancers. But then there are some other mutations that decrease that risk. And overall, I didn't see anything that would incredibly change, let's say, my lifestyle. My way of thinking. But my way of thinking was influenced by seeing that I have some 3-point-something percentage of genes from Neanderthals. Most of us in the room, unless we are Black African who have remained in Africa, we have our genome mixed with the Neanderthals. Because when 10,000 of us left Africa, some 50,000 or maybe a little bit more, 100,000 years ago, we spread all over the universe, the planet, really literally among the planet, and then those genes are found back in all of us. But we also paired, probably some 20,000 years ago, with another group of hominids that had left before, which are the Neanderthals. And like this, you realize that what you really are is the contribution of the history of all of these people that then in your blood comes together. And it gives you a sense of belonging. And it gives you a sense of belonging also not only to all other human beings, but to all other living beings that also have this thread of code of life that is called DNA, that is genome. So you start distinguishing material that has DNA inside from things that do not have, like stones or typically synthetic material. Wood, food, of course, animal, plants, bacteria, algae, all have it. And so you have a sense, we are really relatives. That is sort of an important thing that one realized. The other point is that whatever we are able to understand now is likely to become much more interesting in the future. So we don't quite understand the language of genes to a great detail, but we expect to be able to read it. And so the idea of putting my genome online is to be able to have people get a real sequence, play around with it. Of course, there are many more others on the internet, but at least take away some of the scare. My life has not changed for worse for having put this sequence. But it is potentially dangerous. And so one of the things that happened in recent times, and so I predict that most of you will get your genome sequenced sooner or later, because it's convenient, because it's important, because it can give a lot of medical information, the majority of which we will be able to interpret in the future. But the point that I would like to make is that almost overnight, in a relatively rapid sort of development, scientists learned how to edit the genome, how to change it. And that is different from the sort of previous gene technology, because it can be done in a very precise fashion, without leaving traces other than the mutant that you want to create in the genome. So for example, if for generations the way we wanted to have a better plant that was resistant to a particular virus or that make bigger fruits was to irradiate with X-rays this plant to make mutations randomly, 10,000s of mutations, just to be hoping that we will find one little plant that will have bigger fruits or be resistant to a virus, now it can be done with a single mutation. Potentially a very interesting development that we are all very eager to see if we can use in an intelligent way. The same is true for bad diseases, diseases in children who are suffering from, for example, muscle waste. We expect in future to be able to correct the mutation in the muscle of the children so that they can live and they can become grown-ups. And there are many, many cases where this would be possible. But you're starting getting scary, and you should get scary, because this is really something that is changing the ability that we have to do other things. For sure, there are some beneficial aspects to this. For example, the ability of re-engineering the environment to the point that we can do bioremediation, so we can try to get rid of some of the sins that we have done in the past by trying to make an environment that is able to cope better with the type of things we have done, and maybe also creating other type of energies. The ability of changing this genome is relatively new, and attached to the ability to read genome is really changing a lot of things. And people have decided, I mean, people mean scientists, together with politicians, have said, okay, for now, we are not going to touch the germline, which is the ability of doing something to your to germ cells so you can pass it on to another generation, because that is a taboo. We don't think that is something that is clever. We don't know yet what we would do if we would do it. Would we make several genes that protect us from cancer? Perhaps. Would we mutate a gene that is involved in Alzheimer? Perhaps. If we knew about it, if we had the certainty that it is a desirable thing, perhaps you would do it. Some of the younger people in this room may see that happen. Now, because we have this uncertainty and because we are scared, we are taking our time to think about it. And my message, if you want, is that you should all think about it, because it is going to be affecting all of you. Are we going to influence the future of humankind by changing some of the properties, or the properties of plants, or the properties of bacteria? So that is an important point. So let's think about how we would change things. What are the things that we would change? Are there medical? Are there other features? And the other point is to do more research. And obviously, it is going beyond the boundaries of the molecular biologist and the molecular medical people, the geneticist. It should interest you all. So everybody should increase the genetic literacy to be able to participate in the discussion. It would be horrible if there would be a small group of people with all the knowledge engineering themselves a different type of humanity, maybe bigger, maybe stronger, maybe with the brains of collected notions from mutations or variants associated with geniuses, and then the other people don't know anything about it, and they, you know, like exactly like Aldous Huxley had described it in Brave New World. So it's important that everybody starts thinking about it without being scared and think, okay, this is a possibility. And here I come to the importance of research and the importance of being open to it by being saying, okay, let's embrace this opportunity. But now I would love to give you a little bit of a consideration that is philosophical. I'm not a philosopher, I'm a scientist, and I don't have a solution, but it blows my mind. Think about the time of history on the planet. It is something like 3.5 billion years that there is life on the planet. Life means there was something, and it has to do with having a genome, having an inheritable material, and that turned out to be nucleic acids, first RNA, we think, but then DNA, just as the DNA that I was describing to you is in all your cells. Now, 3.5 billion is an incredible amount of time. And humans, and I'm not an anthropologist, but let's say that we start calling humans people that can, the apes that start and staying on two legs, bipedalism. That is something like 3 million years ago. And then you can say, okay, but staying on two legs doesn't make you a human. Let's think about when we started making fire, and that was 1 million years ago. 1 million years ago compared to 3.5 billion is really sort of in the last thousands of the history of the planet came these strange apes that we are now here making this interesting TED talk. And these strange apes are now able, for the first time in the history of the planet, not only to read the code that makes them apes, but also to change it. Think about it. You are self-replicating machinery, now for the first time, able to change its fate. Like a robot that can self-code, singularity. Now, irrespectively of whether you have a mystical gene and you hear a divine music behind all of this, or whether you are one of those people who get their kicks by looking at the stars and feeling the gazillions of possibilities that are associated with your existence and do not need to evocate divine intervention, or whether you believe in flying teapots. Irrespective of this, this should blow your mind. You are the first generation that can change the fate of humankind by changing what humankind means and by changing a lot of other things on the planet. So, in reality, I would need to sit down, take a glass of water, and out of this dizzy possibility, trying to realize, what does it mean? Is it just a coincidence? Now, I don't have an answer, and I would like you to think about it, but I would like you also to think, what would you do if you had these possibilities? Because we will have this possibility. Now we have this moratorium. Now we decided not to do much. But eventually, somebody will come up and say, let's protect ourselves from cancer. And certainly, I don't want to have my child die at the year of 5 years of age in a corner shivering with pain. So these are going to be moral challenges that we're going to face, and we need to face them, but in a joyful way, in a way that is empowering. And this act of self-reflection, unique in the history of humankind, believe me, it's different than having the wheel of having invented electricity, because this is something that is changing the paradigm altogether. In this sense, it is going to be very important to think, what would we do? And it is my expectation that the majority of things that you would like to change are moral, are we should stop making war to each other, stop killing each other, stop killing animals, raping the planet, act as if we would be the only, let's say, living creature on the planet. And it is maybe a hope and a wish, and the wish that I would like to leave you with, is that maybe out of our collective responsibility will come the realization that it is not by changing our genes that we will achieve all these things, but by the first knowledgeable and willful act of self-reflection, making humanity 2.0, that is suddenly abandoning its ape-like behavior for an adult, enlightened behavior, that where the genes are not enhanced by mutation, but they enhanced virtually by what we think we should be doing on the planet. Thank you very much.
I still have a question. In my preparation for today, I registered on your website, and I just wanted to know, are you still looking for more people who might be interested in decoding their genome?
Absolutely. So there is www.genomeaustria.at. You should go there, read all about it, and we will be interested in your candidating. What we now have is a system by which you need to prove that you understand the risks associated with knowing your genome. There are many risks that have to do with the responsibility with your children, because you may take a decision for yourself, but it's difficult to take the decision for your children. And if you pass that exam, then you're eligible. And right now, we have a lot of people who are interested, and we have too little money to be doing enough, but there is a notary that helps us select by random those people. So whether you consider it luck or no luck, maybe you're able to get your genome sequenced.
Thank you.